Jared Golden is running for Maine's second congressional district against Bruce Poliquin, and he joins us today in Leeds. Where are you today, sir?
I'm in Lewiston, Maine.
Lewiston, Maine.
I grew up in Leeds.
You were recommended to us by Howie Klein. Just so you know, so I can introduce myself to you, introduce my listeners to you, who are going to go to jaredgoldenforcongress.com, and they're going to donate money to your campaign, and we'll discuss why they should give you money. Give Jared Golden $1. That's all you have to do. If every listener gives Jared Golden $1, tomorrow he'll have $2. So I have this little game that I play with Howie Klein because I do whatever Howie Klein tells me to do. He runs the Down with Tyranny blog and raises money for people like you. And I just vote for whomever Howie Klein tells me to. And I try to get them on my show to help and learn. And I run the candidates through the paces and ask them tough questions. But I'm not going to do that with you. I'm just going to ask you some questions.
Sounds good.
Yeah, you deserve as much respect as is humanly possible. Jared Golden was born and raised in Leeds, Maine. It's a dairy farm with about 2,000 people in it. After spending a year at the University of Maine in Farmington, Jared joined the Marine Corps Infantry in response to the September 11th attacks. You served in combat tours in Iraq and Afghanistan. You left as a corporal. You came back to Maine. You attended Bates College and then went to work for Senator Susan Collins on the Homeland Security and Governmental Affairs Committee. She's a Republican, but you ran for the Maine legislature as a Democrat. You ran and you were elected to the Maine House in 2014, representing the city of Lewiston. Now in your second term, you've been elected to serve as the Assistant Majority Leader, which technically would be the whip. Is that correct?
That's correct.
You're the whip in the assembly in Maine.
The House of Representatives.
They call it the House of Representatives. And you are running for Congress, and it's an honor to speak to you, sir.
Thank you. And David, one thing I'll tell you is when I came home from Iraq, I actually ended up taking a couple of jobs. You know, I took the first job I could get my hands on. I worked at a motorhome RV center. Working in the mechanic shop, just kind of cleaning up, and I worked at a pizza shop at night making pizzas, and you know, low wage work, was struggling to make ends meet, and you know, it was a chance encounter and some good luck that led me to the opportunity to go to Bates College, where ultimately I was able to get a great education, but also had it paid for entirely by Department of Veterans Affairs education benefits.
You served in Iraq and Afghanistan, and you left as a corporal.
That's right.
Yeah. The American people are suffering right now. I have been told that, and I hate to use this term in front of you, that the American people have PTSD because of Donald Trump. And that makes me really angry because, you know, we all want things without having to work for it. You suffer from PTSD, is that correct?
Well, I don't know that I would say I suffer from it, but I was diagnosed with post-traumatic stress. That's certainly something I've had to deal with in my life, but it's not something I've allowed to hold me back by any
right,
means.
Right. The reason I mentioned that is people are really shaken by Donald Trump. I know a lot of pampered liberals who say, I can't watch the news anymore. He's driving me crazy. What do you say to my listeners, who I love, but we're not as strong as you? What do you tell the listeners whose hearts are in the right place? They know how to vote. They vote properly. What do you tell them when they get worn down by Trump?
Well, I like to say that elections have consequences, big consequences for people's lives here in the country. And, you know, I recall 2008 when President Obama was elected. And I remember him saying that he, you know, campaigned on change in America, but that he couldn't do it himself, that everyone had to get involved and do their part. And so, you know, in response to those who are feeling shaken up by our current political environment and our new president, I would say it's on you. Roll up your sleeves and get to work. If you want change in this country, you got to fight for it.
How old are you?
35.
You don't realize how much you mean to my listeners, because a lot of them feel hopeless. That's just from listening to my show. That just happens. But when you hear of somebody like you, 35, who served our country, and you're rolling up your sleeves and getting involved, doesn't that help with the trauma by working with other people and getting out of yourself and being part of the community and fixing it? You, in many ways, fix yourself.
I think that's absolutely true. I mean, you gotta work hard for everything in life, is my personal opinion, but I've always been most happy in life and at my best when I'm serving. Mm-hmm. That's ultimately, military service in the state legislature here, those are the happiest times in my life. And I think it's being a part of something bigger than yourself that can really make people find value in their lives and feel good about what they're doing.
I have two issues that I believe in. One is Medicare for All. Where do you stand on Medicare for All?
I support Medicare for All. I'll tell you, looking back at the passage of the Affordable Care Act, I think we made some progress. It expanded coverage for a lot of Americans who couldn't afford it before. But I think we also know that insurance companies and drug companies lobbied Congress and that the ACA fell short of its full intent. And I worry that as a result, it was really kind of hamstrung in some ways. Thinking about the court decision that Medicaid expansion was optional.
Is it LePage? Who's the crazy governor you've got?
Governor Paul LePage.
Did he accept Medicaid expansion?
No. So like I was saying, we have the system in place in this country now where many states have rejected Medicaid expansion, and Maine is one of them. The Maine state legislature passed legislation to expand Medicaid, to accept those federal dollars to provide health care coverage to 70,000 people in this state, and the governor vetoed it 5 times. We've never had the majorities we needed to override that veto. The good news is, on election day, just next week, on the ballot for the people to decide is whether or not to accept Medicaid expansion, and it would be roughly $500 million from the federal government to expand access to health care coverage for, like I said, 70,000 people in this state.
So you're having a referendum on whether or not to accept the Medicaid expansion. That's fascinating. I've never heard of that. Who's lobbying against the Medicaid?
There's not many people lobbying against it. The governor is staunchly against it. Republicans in the legislature, particularly in the House, have stacked up behind him on that. And they have tried to portray Medicaid as coverage for able-bodied working people who just don't want to work, which is completely false. 1 in 5 people in Maine right now are on Medicaid. And actually, a lot of those people are elderly who have Medicare but have long-term assisted care needs that aren't covered by Medicare. So they end up drawing down on Medicaid. So it's really a stereotype that the governor has pushed, but the hospitals, so many organizations here in Maine have all advocated for accepting Medicaid expansion. It actually makes fiscal sense that, for a cost of maybe $50 million a year from the state budget, we could in return get $500 million from the federal government. And taxpayer dollars.
Yeah, why would you reject federal money?
Political ideology.
It's not going to affect your budget.
Well, like I said, we would have to pay about $50 million, but sometimes you got to pay a little bit of money to get some. So
$50 million to get $500 million?
Yeah, that's easy math, David.
You pay $50 million to get $500 million, and your governor doesn't want to do that.
Another thing I'll tell you, a very rural state, we have rural hospitals that are struggling to keep their doors open. And if they go under, people are going to have to drive very long distances to get the care that they need. But on top of that, these are some of the largest employers in our state. And the estimate is that, these are numbers that have been looked at over many years. Like I said, we've passed this 5 times. Easily 3,000 jobs would be created if we expanded Medicaid.
If the voters vote for expanding Medicaid, it gets challenged in the courts. What happens?
Well, a lot of things could happen. Certainly the governor or Republican legislator could submit a bill to repeal what the voters voted for. So long as Democrats have control of the House, that's not going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
But it's always a possibility. I mean, it is not a mandate when it passes. It is in the sense that voters approved it, but the legislature does have the power to ignore that.
What do you think is going to happen?
Well, we saw a poll today that suggested that 69% of voters, likely voters, support that. I think it's going to pass, and I think that we've got that House majority, and that'll be enough to make sure that it moves forward.
Explain to me the legislative process in Maine, just out of curiosity. So the Republicans control what, and what do the Democrats control?
Well, the governor has the Blaine House. He's a Republican.
Right.
And Republicans have controlled the Senate by narrow margins since 2014, but Democrats have controlled the House since 2012.
You're the whip. The job of the whip is to just get the votes out.
That's right. I mean, there's a lot more to it than that. It's supporting members as they try and move their legislation through the process. It's making sure that people are there to take the votes when it's time to do that. And, you know, building consensus so that we can stick together. I mean, you can't have the benefit of being in the majority if you don't stick together.
Is it a fascinating process getting a bill passed? Yeah. They say it's like making sausage. It's better not to know how these bills get made. Is that true?
Oh, I don't think that's true, to be honest with you. I've been quite successful up here. I have passed many bills into law in just 3 years' time. I've passed legislation that's gotten the state involved in providing mental health care to veterans, mm-hmm. Getting the state active in addressing homelessness. I've passed bills to help firefighters and police officers get workers' compensation when they're diagnosed with post-traumatic stress because of the work that they do. So it's a fascinating process. And what's most important is you got to put the time in. You got to work hard. If you're not willing to do that, then you're not going to get anything done.
Going back to Medicaid expansion, because this is what I care about most. It's health care for all. I can't believe we don't have it already. Romney Care in Massachusetts, is that successful? And Vermont, your neighbor, tried some form of Medicare for all. What happened with Medicare for all in Vermont? What happened in Massachusetts? And as somebody who has gone to the VA, it was my understanding that the VA was a shining example of socialized medicine until George W. Bush became president. How were you treated by the VA, and what condition is it in right now?
Well, you know, I would say that the care and benefits I got from the VA were mixed. And certainly at times it's been very helpful. At other times, it was a bureaucratic process that threw up a lot of roadblocks, and I really had to work hard to get those benefits. I mean, I could tell you a couple of stories about that, but overall, I think the problems with the VA is they were underfunded and understaffed. They weren't ready for the volume of veterans and care that was needed when they came home, and I would put that right back on Congress and our political leaders. But there's many veterans that think that they get great care from the VA.
Yeah.
And so it is an example of how a government healthcare system can work. Absolutely.
What happened?
That being said, Vermont and Massachusetts, I think, my opinion, David, is that this isn't something that can be done state by state. If government healthcare, a Medicare for all system is going to work, it's going to have to come at the federal level.
Is it working in Massachusetts?
And, you know, to be honest with you, I don't know. You'd have to ask someone from Massachusetts. I'm sure that it's working in some aspects, and there's probably some flaws. But again, there's going to be flaws in a state healthcare system that isn't in line with what the federal government is doing.
Paul LePage, I remember this guy for two reasons. I remember when he took over as governor, there were paintings or murals inside the state capitol that celebrated the working man. They were kind of like the Diego Rivera murals in Rockefeller Center. And he had them taken down because they reeked of socialism. Is that true?
Not completely. The murals were honoring our past of you know, having a lot of industries that had union workers of the labor movement, and the governor is deeply opposed to unions. He believes that Maine should be a right to work state with no unions, and that's why he took them down. Was he is just completely opposed to unions in this state.
And then with your opiate crisis, he said something incredibly racist. That's what I remember from him, saying that African Americans were driving up to Maine and making their drops with the drugs and then getting our white women pregnant. Am I paraphrasing that close enough?
You're paraphrasing that quite closely.
Yeah.
But I'll tell you, when it comes to the opiate crisis here in Maine, it goes beyond the governor's comments about the issue. It's also a lack of responsible action. He has said things like, there's nothing we can do to help people who are suffering from opiate addictions. We shouldn't be giving them things like Narcan that help keep them alive, because what's really going to do away with this opiate crisis is we're just going to have to let these people die off.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's a much broader problem with this governor, but the legislature has taken action where he has not, and we've done the best we can to provide people the care that they need.
I remember there was a headline in the New York Times about a city in Poland that had no Jews, and the mayor was running on an anti-Semitic platform, and the headline was, "Can anti-Semitism exist without Jews?" Your state is something like 95% white.
Yeah, those are the demographics. But to be honest with you, David, here where I'm from in Lewiston, we have quite a population of immigrants that came from Somalia. Mm-hmm. We also from West Africa. They've been here a long time now, and actually many of them are naturalized citizens. We just had last year our first graduating class of seniors of American-born Somali men and women, and it's been largely a great benefit to the community.
How does your governor run using race when it's not an issue in Maine? How do you do that?
That's a great question, but I think really I guess if you're asking how did he win,
yeah,
it's because we had a third party candidate, an independent running, who siphoned off a lot of votes. And ultimately, I mean, the first time Paula Page got elected, it was with less than 40% of the vote. And the second time it was with less than 50% of the vote. He's never had broad based support and a full on mandate. He's always benefited from having multiple candidates on the ballot.
Does race play when we watch Trump get elected using race, and the Mexicans are coming and the blacks are coming? If you live in a state where you're all white, can you run as a conservative who says we're under siege here, and will people buy into that?
Well, I think what you can do is you can point to immigration that's taking place in a state and claim that it's illegal immigrants who are hiding in the shadows and haven't come out. That's not the truth, but you can try and play to people's fear and lack of understanding of the system.
Yeah.
You know, he's tried to tie that to people's fear of terrorism. But to be honest with you, that's not why he won. He won on other issues. He harps on welfare and the need for welfare reform. Paula Page is a guy that grew up poor right here in Lewiston, where I'm from, and describes himself as a self-made man. Ignores, I think, the fact that he got a lot of help along the way. But you know, he has consistently run saying that Maine is a welfare state and that we need to fix that. And I think that sometimes people have agreed with that, not because they have an issue with welfare. I think most Mainers want to support their neighbors, but because they think that those programs aren't actually helping lift people out of poverty. So when someone is out there consistently saying we need to reform welfare, they agree.
Yeah. So the district you're running for, it's the second district, that's kind of up for grabs. You currently have Bruce I don't know if I'm pronouncing his name, Poliquin. He's the Republican. Was that a Democratic seat before Poliquin?
Democrats held this seat from 1994 to 2014.
So what happened?
And that's when Bruce Poliquin was elected.
So what year did Poliquin get it?
2014.
So who did he beat? He beat Emily Kane?
Emily Kane, that's correct.
What happened in 2014?
Well, 2014 wasn't a great year for Democrats nationally or in this state. You know, the governor was on the ballot. I think he had a down ballot impact
Sure. Yeah.
But at the same time, I just, you know, in many ways, Bruce Poliquin was able to portray himself as someone that fit the district better than his opponent.
Emily Kane outspent him, and she still lost. Is she running? Because you haven't won the nomination yet. That's what I wanted to ask you about.
No.
Emily Kane running again?
No, Emily's not running.
Okay. The Democratic Party is supposed to speak for the working man since William Jennings Bryan, I believe. It's been the party for the poor. I'm going to assume, because most people in Congress who are Democrats are self-made millionaires who believe in the system. Are you a self-made millionaire?
No, I'm far from being a millionaire.
You're 35 years old, so you're not a millionaire.
David, I've had to work for every dollar that's come my way.
And, but your parents are rich. But your parents are rich, right?
Yeah, that's funny. I think you're joking, right?
Yeah. There's a problem in the Democratic Party, and Howie Klein talks about this all the time. We have millionaires who are self-financing in the Democratic Party because they're bored and they want to be a congressperson. There is something grossly wrong with Democrats who are millionaires, especially the children of millionaires, who decide they want to be congresspeople. How many opponents do you have in the primary?
There are five Democrats running in this primary.
How many of them are men? How many of them are women?
In this year, all men.
All men. How many of them served in the military?
Just me.
How many of them are millionaires?
You know, I don't know the answer to that question, but actually one. That I could be wrong, but I think just one. I want to be sure to point out, David, that being wealthy, being a millionaire, doesn't mean that you're not fit to serve in Congress. I think what's most important.
Well, it does mean
are you running for Congress, and what do you want to accomplish for the people that you want to represent, and do you understand their issues and their challenges? That's what matters. So, mm-hmm. You know, being rich or being wealthy doesn't mean you shouldn't be a Democrat or that you shouldn't be in Congress. But I do think in this case, particularly at this time in Maine, it's important to have someone who really understands the challenges that people in the state are facing. And I understand that because I'm one of these people. I grew up here. Like you said, I'm not a millionaire. I'm far from it. I've had to work my way up to where I'm at. And as a result, I understand the challenges that people are facing in this state.
What are the biggest challenges facing the people of Maine that Washington can fix?
Well, I mean, Maine is a good example of an economy that is leaving a lot of parts of this country behind. Similar to what we've seen in the Rust Belt, this was a manufacturing community. This was, we're a rural, very rural-based economy, traditional work on farms, marine resources, mills. And ever since NAFTA, a lot of our paper mills have declined. Many of them have shut down, particularly in the last decade. And so what were good middle-class jobs have disappeared and largely been replaced by low-wage work, a service sector economy, and people that worked hard and were doing well are now working harder and not doing well. That's one of the biggest challenges we face. At the same time, as a result, we're the oldest state in the nation, and we're getting older. People are leaving because they don't see good opportunities to work hard and get ahead in this state.
And what's happening to Main Street in Maine?
Main Street in Maine was decimated.
By whom?
By the closure of these mills. I mean, in many of these communities, everything was built around those jobs.
And what about the big box stores and Amazon?
Those stores are here. I mean, we got a Walmart in Lewiston, Auburn, for sure. But you know, I think ultimately when you're losing middle-class jobs, there's not people to support the small businesses on Main Street. At the same time, you know, we are starting to see some revitalization in our downtowns and in some areas. Lewiston, where I'm from, is one of them. But it's been hard growth, and it's had to come through a refocus on small business growth.
What committee would you like to serve on?
Well, that's a good question. I've served in the Maine State Legislature on the Veterans Committee. I've served on the Transportation Committee. Infrastructure is something that I think is very important to Maine. Could, you know, a strong infrastructure package and investment in the country and in Maine could, I think, breathe some life into our economy and create some good jobs and also set up the kind of infrastructure that supports small businesses and entrepreneurship. So those are two committees that I'm familiar with and think are very important to Maine. 10% of the population of Maine are veterans, so also a very important potential committee assignment.
My second issue, and you're not going to like this, is to bring back the draft. That would solve a lot of problems in this country. I know a lot of older progressives who pushed Nixon, you know, they got rid of the draft during the Nixon administration. And looking back, they say it was the biggest mistake they've made. Do you think we'd be in as many wars right now? You know, we're just finding out that we have troops being killed in Niger. We have troops in Yemen. We have troops all over the world fighting this war on terror. If we had a draft, what do you think this country would look like?
Well, I agree with the problems that you've pointed out. I also, you know, I wasn't alive during the Vietnam War, but I understand that there was a lot of problems with the draft system, that there was a lot of inequalities and a lot of people that were being asked to go fight a war that they didn't believe in. And today I see a problem where so few Americans serve. On the flip side, less than 1% of the population. And there's a problematic military-civilian divide, in my opinion. People don't understand and appreciate the experiences of service members today. From my perspective, that's because of a lack of involvement from society. And we need to get more engaged in these decisions about where we send our men and women to fight. So when I was in the Marines and I came home from Afghanistan, and I had friends that I served with that were killed there, who died fighting for our country. And it felt to me like a lot of people back home just weren't paying attention to the war at all, almost like it just wasn't their problem. And that was in 2004. It was just a few short years after 9/11. And I think that lack of attention is actually a blank check for Congress from the American people. We're not holding elected leaders accountable for the decision to go to war. Like you said, we've been at war for 16 straight years, and so few are doing the fighting. And meanwhile, we're spending trillions of dollars, a lot of which could be spent right here rebuilding America. So I think we need better dialogue about that. I think it's hard to see how the draft would change that necessarily. But Americans generally need more incentive to serve, maybe not just in the military, but in other service programs like AmeriCorps, Teach for America, and other organizations. So for me, I learned so much from my military service, and I have a very, you know, like I spoke of before, I really feel best when I'm serving and committing myself to community and to the country. And I think it's taught me to be a leader. It's taught me to appreciate this country better, having been to a place like Afghanistan and seeing the lives that people are living over there. I don't take anything for granted. And that's an important lesson in life. So, you know, you said there's a lot of people here who are feeling sorry for themselves and feeling like America's down and out. Well, you know, I got something to tell them. Things are a lot worse in other places. And I think that service, whether it be in the military or like I said, serving in disadvantaged communities across the country, could really teach people a lot.
Yeah, it's a cliche to remind my listeners of this, but after 9/11, George W. Bush said, if you want to help, go shopping. That's what he said. He didn't bring back the draft. He started a war on terror that nobody had to do anything for. He gave us tax cuts for this war on terror.
No common sense of purpose, no common sacrifice, put it all on the backs of the few. That was an outrageous statement, certainly. And, you know, a quick story for you. When I got home from Iraq, David, I remember sitting in my car in the community I'm from, and there was stopped at a light. There was a big SUV in front of me, and on that SUV's bumper was a big sticker. I'm sure you've seen them before. It said, "No blood for oil." Mm-hmm. And I looked at that and I thought, well, there's someone who's not thinking about how they're contributing to these wars. They're saying that they don't support the war in Iraq, yet they're driving this giant gas-guzzling vehicle, which necessitates, you know, our dependency on oil and drives the conflicts in the Middle East. That's the ways in which I think American people are disengaged and not thinking about what's their role in a better America.
Was it a war for oil?
I mean, you tell me. We know it wasn't necessarily about weapons of mass destruction. Never found them there.
When you enlisted and joined the Marines, you were how old?
I was 20 years old.
You were 20 years old. And you were going to college, right?
That's right. I wanted to be a high school history teacher.
Okay. Did you... don't mean to ask you personal questions. You don't have to answer this. I'm just curious. You work for Susan Collins, who is a putative Republican. Supposedly she's a Republican. Were you a Republican at the time?
No, I've been a Democrat since I was able to register. 18 years old and senior in high school, I, you know, signed up to vote and did so as a Democrat.
I apologize for asking you this question. Did you believe George W. Bush when he said there were weapons of mass destruction in Iraq?
I remember feeling that the threat was very real at that time. And also, you'll remember they were drawing a connection to the war on terror. They were suggesting ties between the Saddam regime.
That was my second question. Did you believe they pretty much said that Saddam Hussein was behind 9/11? When you enlisted, did you believe that Saddam Hussein was behind 9/11?
Behind 9/11, no. Did I believe that there may have been ties with Al-Qaeda and other terrorist organizations? Yes.
And
but,
now?
You know,
and
once
now?
I joined and once and, I
and
served,
that, excuse
that
me,
was
sir.
All...
Sir?
Yeah. Yeah.
And now, for the record, because there are still people who write for the Weekly Standard, Bill Kristol's rag, Bill Kristol invented the invasion of Iraq, they are still saying that they found weapons of mass destruction in Iraq. Having served in Iraq, were there weapons of mass destruction there?
Not to the best of my knowledge. I don't think that's really up for debate.
Well, they're still writing in the Weekly Standard that they found weapons of mass destruction. Was there any link between Saddam Hussein and 9/11?
No.
There was no link?
No. I mean, do you think there was?
Of course not. Should we have invaded Iraq?
That's a tough question right there. I can tell you that when I was serving in the Marines in Afghanistan, I did not think that going into Iraq was a smart decision. I thought that it was detracting away from what I thought was the main effort, which was a response to the September 11 attacks in Afghanistan and taking the fight to Al-Qaeda. I thought it was revisiting an issue that goes back to the first Gulf War, and I didn't see the need for it. Being said, it was my mission and I did it.
Right. Sarah Huckabee Sanders, 2 weeks ago, was talking about the Gold Star mom and the controversy involving Donald Trump's telephone call and General Kelly, who's the White House chief of staff, who is a Gold Star father. Sarah Huckabee Sanders, the spokesman, said to a reporter, "If you want to go ahead and pick a fight with General Kelly, a four-star general, go right ahead." My response is, I support the troops. I do not support the generals. They should be held with contempt and not to be trusted, especially General Kelly, who the war on undocumented workers he waged as head of Homeland Security is a disgrace. And what he said about Robert E. Lee this week is a disgrace. By bringing back the draft, we would no longer be walking on eggshells the way I am right now when I question the wisdom of the Pentagon. By not having a draft, it makes regular people like me who didn't serve feel like cowards and feel it's inappropriate to question the Pentagon. And that's why the war in Afghanistan, how many years are we there now? 16 years?
16 years.
That's longer than Vietnam.
I'm going to disagree with you, David. I think you have an obligation to question and analyze and push our leaders, whether they're military leaders, whether they're civilian leaders, political leaders. And, you know, General Kennedy and others are now political leaders. They're not generals anymore. But what I would say is that in my experience in the military, they preach that leaders take responsibility for failures, full responsibility, period. And they're not serving to take credit for success. They breed a culture of leaders who are always thinking about what's best for the people that they lead. And in this case, they're leading our country, and that it's not about themselves. And they must always be open to criticism and answer to it.
That's all nice. That's nice that you're saying that. And that's what Kelly would say. And that's what Mattis would say. But the fact is, if there's no draft, you become high priests and it becomes clouded in mystery and you use all these magical terms and it's wrong to question the military because they make the ultimate sacrifice, which they do. You know, I can't say that I have skin in the game because I don't. So you get away with literally murder because nobody's questioning the military because we don't know what you're going through and what you have to do, and we don't know what these terms mean. I grew up, my father served in World War II, so he didn't respect the military. He knew generals and admirals were full of it, and he had earned the right because he enlisted to question these people. I can remember growing up and him arguing with fellow soldiers about the war in Vietnam. He knew what war was about. The problem is we have an entire country that doesn't know what war means. And they don't care. And the only way to fix this is to bring back the draft. I don't think we'd be spending $700 billion a year on defense if our citizens were forced to serve and find out where that money actually goes. Why is nobody pushing for a draft?
That's a good question, David. I mean, I honestly have to ask you, was it really any different during the Vietnam War or during World War II? Were generals treated any differently when draft or when more people served?
But you know what? The admiral who was in charge of Pearl Harbor was fired. There was a committee and they investigated him.
Well, you can fire generals, you can fire admirals. We fired many generals during these wars.
Petraeus is still a hero.
Yeah. Well, you know, I'm going to just have to, you know.
You know why Harry Truman was picked by Roosevelt? Because in the Senate, he looked into fraud. He was the one who was investigating the defense contractors and was traveling around the country proving that the defense contractors were more concerned about defrauding the United States government than beating Japan and Germany. That's what the country was like back then because everybody had skin in the game. So you don't support bringing back the draft, obviously.
I think that you're looking for, you know, something that's going to solve a problem that we both agree on. And I don't think that I agree that it would solve it. I think that this goes back to holding our leaders accountable. That's on Congress to do. That's on voters to do. That's on the entire country to hold our leaders accountable. And I don't think that would change by bringing back a draft.
Okay. Well,
that's the responsibility of every American.
To hold their leaders accountable.
Yes.
Okay. Well, go to jaredgoldenforcongress.com and give him money. I can say that on the podcast. I can't say that on the radio show. It's an honor to talk to you, sir. And thank you for inspiring everybody, because a lot of us are lost and terrified, and we feel we're losing our country, and when we get to hear people like you who are willing to step up. Once again, you're willing to step up. Thank you.
Well, thank you. I appreciate it. Always happy to step up.
Thank you, sir. Stay on the line for 1 second.